welcome to Money Life. This time I'm going to talk about Pramod Mittal. Pramod Mittal used to once head a large steel empire in India called Ispat Industries, had various other companies including Ispat Profiles, all of which were sold out in about 2010. Why was he in the news? Because he was arrested in Bosnia on 24th July. He was released on 30th July, but not so easily. He had to pay up some amount of money. So what he did was he paid 12.5 million in order to get secure his release within a week. He had two other of his employees arrested as well. And apart from paying this money, he also had to give a sort of insurance, or what I would think was an escrow payment, of 11 million euros in order to be released from jail. Of course, Mittal has been putting out releases saying that this is all political and motivated, but take a look at why I think this is so typical. Now, why are we talking about Pramod Mittal, who's sitting in the UK? Because at a time when India's bad loans with banks are over 10 lakh crore, and so many of our PSU banks are being merged and literally closed down, we need to remember that it is the business nexus with political interference that has caused these bad loans, and the Mittals, the two Indian Mittals, Pramod and brother Vinod, had a big role to play in dumping a lot of bad loans on Indian banks. And it's time to recollect how this used to happen. Now, why was Pramod Mittal arrested in Bosnia? Because the Bosnian government alleges suspicious transfer of nearly 11 million, which is the amount he's put in what is called an insurance. This is from a company called GIKIL, which is Global Ispat Kokana Industry, which is a partnership between Mittal's flagship overseas company called Global Steel Holdings and the government of Bosnia. This company was set up in 2003 and has over 1,000 employees. What is relevant here is that it was sort of joint venture of the government. The government is involved in the action that was taken, and they have waited a long time. And I will narrate how and when this happened. But this is an ongoing thing. It's over 10 years later that he made the mistake, I would think, of entering Bosnia and got arrested. It's bad times for Indian industrialists, but don't forget the bad loans that they have inflicted. Now, this is not his only brush with problems. In India, as recently as May, after long drawn litigation that landed up in the Supreme Court, he had to pay up a huge amount of money on account of what he owed to State Trading Corporation. Now, again, a lot of young people who hear these videos wouldn't even have heard the power of State Trading Corporation. It was once a huge government monopoly at a time when we were in the closed economy and only STC was allowed to do a lot of international trades. Things had to be routed through them. So he owed $200 million to STC, and his brother, Lakshmi Mittal, who is one of the richest people in the world, runs a completely separate empire, headed by ArcelorMittal, the flagship company. He paid up that money and helped Pramod Mittal stay out of jail. It's a little bit like Mukesh Ambani bailing out younger brother Anil, and coincidentally happened around the same time in May this year. So two brushes. One, he escaped from jail. Second, he landed in jail in Bosnia. Now, why was this happening? Because this is the manner in which he does business. You know, when I read the story, I recollected all the writing that I did in the 90s and in early 2000, right up to 2010, when he was finally forced to sell Ispat Industries. And a few things, few stories and anecdotes are worth recollecting, because it's important to know the kind of nexus that worked between banks, bureaucrats, politicians, and business. So the story that I particularly remember was that of the amount of money that they owed for electricity to MSEB, which is Maharashtra State Electricity Board. Now, if you and I don't pay up an electricity bill, it gets cut the next month. You may get at the most 1 month to pay. Look at what happens to our industrialists. So he owed a fat amount to MSEB, but every time this payment came up and they cut electricity, within hours, the phone lines between Bombay and Delhi would be burnt by two powerful ministers, one based in Bombay and one his brother-in-law in Delhi, both in ministries, one in the state, one in Delhi, and within hours the connection would be restored. So the time that I'm talking about, the outstanding was just 80 crores. Repeatedly, the bills weren't paid, the electricity was cut, and, you know, after phone calls from Delhi and Bombay, it used to be restored. He was so difficult that he did not even pay up after the electricity was cut and there were calls. And look at the brazenness. The outstanding bill was allowed to mount from 80 crores to 247 crores. Finally, MSCB had a rather tough IAS officer as its chairman who put his foot down at 270 crore and said he would not restore it despite the pressure and the calls, and forced them to create an escrow account of sorts and start paying on a staggered basis. None of us, not even for our small payments running into a few hundred rupees, get this kind of concession. But this is the manner in which everybody allowed their debts to mount. It wasn't just electricity. Electricity was typical of their attitude to business. If they did not pay electricity bills when it could be cut off and their production could be stopped, imagine their attitude to banks. Those days, there used to be something called an inter-institutional meeting. And the most powerful lenders were development finance institutions, which were IDBI and ICICI, who have later got converted into banks. I used to get confidential reports from, top secret reports from the lenders at their meetings. What used to be really surprising is that very candidly, the officers who created those notes and documents had mentioned the kind of money that was being siphoned off from the loans that were extended to these companies of Pramod Mittal, the Ispat Group. And they ran into hundreds of crores. What stupefies me when we look at the kind of, you know, 10 lakh crore hasn't happened overnight. It's happened because hundreds of crores were allowed to be taken out with no action. So I have been writing from the 90s for over 20 years and nothing happens. You know, the loans kept mounting. Hundreds of crores became thousands of crores and the money kept seeping out. Finally, they were also pledging their shares. Things reached a stage in 2010 when their outstandings were so high, their entire equity was pledged, and people like me and other journalists began to write and ask, why are these institutions not forcing a change in management? So for a while, I think they were just pushed to do something. They tried to get the Tatas to buy it. Tatas made a very lowball offer. And finally, Jindal Steel acquired this company in 2010. Bankers took a huge haircut. And remember, this happened after multiple times when the loans went under restructuring. There were write-offs, there were concessions. And these concessions were not small. There were hundreds of crores. This is our money that banks were merrily doling out to large industrialists who were simultaneously building a parallel empire abroad. So when I say their last company was sold in 2010, what you need to remember is right from 2003 and earlier, they had started building a global empire. And I'm going to talk about that now. Those who know Pramod Mittal, this includes international bankers, say that he had it coming, his problems in Bosnia. And he has an empire that extends from Nigeria to Bulgaria. And he has, of course, shifted base to London. In fact, he has a $17 million bungalow in London, huge place, which is so beautifully appointed and laid out that a former institutional chairman actually had the temerity to tell me to call it Indraprastha, the abode of Lord Indra, who is, you know, the leader of the gods, Hindu gods as we know them. And these chairmen have been guests and visitors over there. They knew that most of it was built from money that went out from India. There was no action taken because they were happy to enjoy this largesse. One of the things that Pramod Mittal did is he loved to drop names. In fact, I remember about 15 years ago when I met him for the first time, he dropped a series of names, including that of an Indian prime minister and, of course, leaders from abroad. He talked about how they came and visited him and he visited them. And he talked about how this Indian prime minister used to visit him in the night, but used to keep a distance during the day and pretend not to know him well. All this was put to good use, not just in India, but all over the world. The pattern, the modus operandi is similar. Get political clout and use it to build a reputation, to raise money, and of course, oftentimes to intimidate bankers. Should bankers have got intimidated? I think not, but this is what they did. How did his global empire start? It actually started with STC, where his brother has now paid up money for him. So STC began to do some raw material imports for him very early in 2000, somewhere before 2004 and 5. And this started with the Philippines initially. There was a lot of borrowing. From there, Mittal quickly defaulted. STC had paid the money and that kept mounting, but this it didn't stop business. This continued. Very quickly, he had operations in multiple parts of the world. In fact, they have companies all over the world in tax havens, which are all well known, have been part of court documents and are listed all over the place. There's not much action. In fact, it's the reason I'm doing this column at all is the fact that there's not much action to trace where this money has gone. So after Philippines, Mr. Mittal quickly moved to Nigeria, Bosnia, finally Bulgaria, each time buying political clout. In July 2013, which is well into 10 years of his global operations, here's what a union, industrial global union, which represents 50 million workers in 140 countries, had to say about how the Mittals do business. And this is up on their website even today. They say about this group, the Ispat Group owned by Pramod Mittal has a record of social destruction in several countries. Its actions in Nigeria, Libya, Bulgaria over the last 5 years illustrate a total institutional disregard for the company's employees and their community, as well as for the law and the national economies in which they operate. How dramatic is that? It doesn't stop at it. It says their record includes lengthy pay arrears going up to 7 months, leading to numerous worker suicides. The company is also known for cannibalizing equipment and exporting it. In fact, this is the kind of, you know, allegation that's made repeatedly against this group in every country. Further says that the immediate provocation for that article was the increasing squeeze on workers at GIKIL, where 92 million of company debt is remaining with this company. Now remember, GIKIL is the same company in Bosnia for which he was eventually arrested. What they call this is an artificial debt created through highly dubious business dealings by GIKIL, purchasing coal at an inflated price for a prolonged period from another subsidiary of the same holding company, Stencom, owned by Global Infrastructure Holding, which is actually, quite simply put, just diversion of funds. That's the allegation. There was 92 million euros outstanding, and they're accusing him of having diverted money. In fact, the allegations in Bosnia are pretty serious in that case. 6 years later, you can see the numbers. The Bosnian government certainly managed to get Pramod Mittal to cough up a lot of that money for his freedom. One serious charge over there is his link to organized crime. Now, that case is going to go on. We need to see how that pans out. Or after all the money is paid, it's simply dropped, because most countries, most people are interested in getting their money back. That is a priority. It's only in India that we forget about the money because it belongs to the public or public sector banks, and who cares, right? So now I have a European banker source who tells me a bit about what his operations are overseas. So he says, apart from Bosnia, if Mittal ever goes back to Bulgaria, he's going to face a lot of trouble over there as well. Now, in Bulgaria, he made global news. Okay, he acquired one of Bulgaria's biggest public sector companies called Kremikovitsi Steel. This company was huge in Bulgaria. Soon as he acquired it, the first thing he did is to float a bond issue, and he raised 325 million euros in bonds. This was in 2006. Simultaneously, he was strutting around buying popularity. So he bought, you know that Europe is very football crazy as a nation, and Bulgaria had a top football club called CSKA. It used to win a lot of awards, has been on the decline ever since, or a little before Pramod Mittal entered. So he walked in there, took over that football club from somebody who was known as a gambling king, one of the richest men of Bulgaria. So what one of the richest men in Bulgaria couldn't run, he got in. There was a lot of hoopla and promise that he was going to invest more money in this club, bring it back to what it was. Nothing of that sort happened. Less than 2 years after he acquired the club, amidst great controversy, he just dumped it, sold it. In fact, one of the things he did immediately after buying the club was to get a top politician in there. And that top politician, again, was accused of some kind of embezzlement later on. But less than 2 years, the club is bought and sold. He's got his day in the sun. He's raised 325 million in bonds. And less than a year later, he begins to default. In 2008, all the people who bought the bonds were trying to look at what action they can take legally in order to recover their money. I don't think they have succeeded, but this has been the story everywhere. The same story in Nigeria. In Nigeria, a bunch of Indian families were actually isolated, kept without salaries for a long time. He employed Indians, mistreated them. It's a global union that has been talking about it, and I wrote about that. In fact, in 2008, the Nigerian government cancelled its contract to two steel companies. There were allegations, again as usual, of asset stripping, and most employees were left high and dry. Now, Pramod Mittal and his PR people may argue that this is a one-sided view, but what is one-sided when the same pattern recurs over and over again, not just in India, but all over the world? I mean, Mittal may say there's a political vendetta or political action. My question is, why aren't we doing anything to recover some of the money that he owes Indian banks? Why have we forgotten? Why aren't we looking at it? After all, this government is going after a lot of people. We have got Nirav Modi, managed to track him. ED is talking about how they got him through his mysterious social media account. Vijay Mallya says, I have all the money. But they're going after him. He's lost his swagger and flamboyance. It's got his back against the wall. We can go after Vijay Mallya for a much smaller sum. Why are we letting go of Mr. Mittal, who is damaging India's reputation abroad through dubious business tactics which lead to this kind of arrested ignominy? I think it's something for us to think about at a time when we are all concerned about the state of the economy, the state of Indian banks, and the fact that we expect more public money to recapitalize them. Thank you.